another episode in the local marketing mini-series, with this one focused on the power of targeted direct mail. Welcome to Fordify, where we help you fortify your business. Now, each week, we pick a random topic chosen by the Fordify button. So let's see what this week's episode is going to be about. Direct mail for your local business. Now, in an age where local businesses have abandoned traditional direct mail, opting for digital solutions, you may be missing huge opportunities to get attention, improve your response rates, lower your cost per lead, and absolutely make more money. Direct mail still offers one of the most consistent, effective forms of advertising for local businesses. But maybe you've tried it and you failed to produce results. Now, in this episode, I'm going to reveal the secret formula that you can use for direct mail to use it successfully. Whether you're promoting a specific offer or it's part of a larger integrated campaign, it's a fact that people are receiving less direct mail than they used to. So you have a much better chance of getting their attention when you use this formula. Now, the formula has three parts. How many? Three. Okay. So the first part of the formula is the list. The second part is the offer. And the third part is the creative. Think of it as the who, the what, and the how. The list is the most important element. Keep in mind that there are two main types of lists. There's your in-house list and rented lists. Your in-house list is your customer database list. A rented list is one that you're going to get from a mailing house or a list broker. In the case of a rented list, you're actually just renting the names based on specific criteria like demographics or a zip code. So let's focus on the in-house list first. You should be building and maintaining your in-house customer list. You should be capturing your customers' mailing addresses in a database, or at least their zip codes. Get their name and address, and then maybe you can get more detail like their behaviors, what they bought, their email, and then of course their phone numbers. As you develop trust, you can gather those other details through things like contests, surveys, giveaways, and of course social media. The more you know about your customers, the better it is for you to be able to target direct mail. Many mailing companies provide a range of address verification services that will check your existing addresses against the USPS database, allowing you to mail confidently with the knowledge that your communication is actually going to reach a valid address. At the very, very least, you want to make sure that your mailing list is CAS certified. CAS stands for Coding Accurate Support System. This helps mailers improve the accuracy of delivery, and it also gives you discounts. The second category of lists is your rented list. This is if you're gonna go rent a mailing list from a mail house or a list broker. These come in every imaginable source and size and criteria available, allowing you to pinpoint new prospects. There are list brokers that can help you identify the most responsive lists for your particular mailing campaign. List brokers can really help you determine the right contacts for your campaigns. When renting, you need to ask the broker, how current is the list? Was it a compiled list or a response list? See, compiled means that it was gathered from other resources. A response list means that it's been built using actual customer responses like other offers, or maybe it's a magazine subscription list or a catalog list, or even associations. They actually rent their lists too. Look in the description for a link to my top 10 list brokers. Now, I'm not affiliated with any of them, but I wanted to give you a resource on where you could get some list brokers. Now let's move on to the second critical element in direct mail, which is your offer. The marketing message or sales copy is so important, but again, the list is the most important, but this is important too, right? You can send a so-so offer to a great list and still be effective, but you can send the best offer in the world to the wrong list and it's simply a waste of money. That's why the list is so critical. So back to creating the offer. What are you really going to say to your prospects? It starts with your compelling headline. See, 90% of direct mail and other sales copy for that matter starts with a compelling headline. Then it follows up with the supporting benefits, the features, the social proof, an offer, and of course your specific and measurable call to action. So I want you to check out the other Fordify episodes that I've done on headlines and creating compelling offers in the descriptions. Crafting a compelling direct mail message requires you to put yourself in the mind of the prospect. You see, are they getting this direct mail at work or at home? How are they going to be reading your copy? On a postcard, maybe they're going to open up a sales letter, or maybe it's going to be something creative like a lumpy mail piece. Which brings us to the third critical element, the creative. The creative is the format for your mail piece. It goes hand in hand with your offer. If you want your offer to really stand out and grab attention, and you want to avoid falling into the trash, you got to realize that your prospect's only going to take a nanosecond of attention towards your piece. You have to have a compelling headline or teaser copy, or make it interesting for them to open it. A compelling headline on a postcard or a teaser copy on the outside of the envelope helps get the package and the piece noticed and then opened. Now, here are a few of my favorite direct mail creative ideas. The first one I call the double crump. This is where you plan on mailing the same list twice. So what you do is you take your letter. So we're just gonna simulate this. Let's just pretend this is my sales letter. And you're gonna get them printed, and it's gonna have the sales letter offer, whatever you're gonna send on it. And then you're gonna pay a mail house to fold it up and stick it in the envelope and send it out. You're gonna wait a week. Then you're gonna plan your second mailing with the same exact direct mail letter, except this time you pay your mail house to crinkle it up. So let's take, this is letter number one, we'll put that aside. And let's say this is letter number two. So what you do is you pay your mail house, and they'll do this for you, to crinkle it up, then lay it flat, and you can either pay them to write on it, please don't throw this away again, or you can put a post-it on there, or you can have it pre-printed on there, please don't throw this away again. And then the second time, you fold the crinkled letter up, and you send it out in a plain, nice envelope. And when the prospect opens it up, it says, please don't throw this away again. And they look at it like, wow, that's pretty cool. Now, keep in mind, you're probably gonna get some person who's not too sharp, their elevator doesn't go all the way to the top floor, and they're gonna call and complain that you went through their trash and sent it to them. Just ignore it, you didn't, it's fine, it's a creative way. Now, I've done this idea for attorneys and doctors and franchises and local businesses of all different sizes, so don't tell me it won't work if you haven't tried it. Another idea is you can use oversized postcards or even colored envelopes. I like to use those colored Mylar envelopes, those real shiny ones that look like aluminum. And you can also use 3D mailers or pop-ups. Now, I have a company that I've worked with in the past, but I asked them to send me some samples. So they have pop-ups that are interesting. They've got these little pull mailings that, you know, samples. Again, it's not about what the copy says, it's about the creative piece. They've got interactive pieces that fold. The more creative you are, and you can go online and you can Google creative mailing, direct mail ideas, there's tons of companies that can actually help you. The key is you want to think about what would be really interesting to capture my prospect attention. And you want to just give them enough information to take the action step you want them to take. Another idea you might want to do is integrate your mail piece offer into an online action step. Or maybe you want to put a QR code in the piece. The key is to give them an incentive to either go somewhere, to pick up the phone, or to bring that postcard or mailing into the store, or to visit you at a trade show booth. Deciding on your creative, whether it's using postcards, sales letters, small packages, or even lumpy mail, depends on your budget and requires testing, frequency, and tracking your ROI. ROI, of course, is return on investment. Now, you can also key code your call to actions. Now, this is interesting. So when I've done direct mail pieces, I've said things like, ask for extension 22. It doesn't matter if you have extension 22. You know that anybody who asks for 22 came from that particular mailing. Or maybe you can say, ask for Chris. It doesn't matter if you have Chris at your office. Chris can be a boy's name or a man's name or a woman's name, but that gives a chance for you to know where the mailing came from. It might be a catalog number, it might be a coupon number. The key is you want to use something unique, like a unique website link. So whatever direct mail piece you have, look at your calls to action and look at how you can key code it so that you can track the responses from their direct mail. Now, don't even bother with direct mail if you're just going to send out a single mailing, especially without testing to a smaller group first, because you need to really identify what's going to work. It's called a direct mail campaign because it involves multiple touches. It's integrated because it involves other areas like going to your website, calling you on the phone. Now, the one and done mindset is a complete waste of time for direct mail. Direct mail is not dead. The three critical elements that you need to make sure you understand are the list, the offer, and the creative. What's the most important? Right, the list. And then, of course, the other two pieces. Start small, test and track, then roll out larger campaigns once you've dialed in on the winning combination. Now, I hope you enjoyed this episode of Fordify. If so, give it a thumbs up and share this video with your marketing and sales teams. You like what you see? Subscribe to be notified of upcoming episodes. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time on Fordify, where we help you fortify your business. I did it. It's good. And I did a good job. Ready to go to the next one?